this might be trouble today. I'm getting on people's food here in a minute. But I'm very happy to be here. We sound good, okay, don't we? Good?
I think everybody can hear.
I'm happy to be anywhere. Of course, I'm just happy. And I like to say that. But I've known Lindy for quite a while. We met in Elmwood, didn't we? Doing Twilight things. And glad you're here. And glad Dixon's here for 40 years. I am a Shelby County Historian and Community Engagement Manager. And I'm a lifelong Memphian. That's usually what I say, just do that. Otherwise, you're taking my time talking. I do take pride in Beale Street landing and landing in these big riverboats. Last Monday, the American Queen came in for the first time. And it's the largest riverboat ever built. And it was about 90% capacity. We got 1,500 suitcases on and off, and about 800 people. And it took them about 1,200 boxes of food product from here, 500 cases of produce. They took down 30 boxes of 2 dozen eggs each, I think. It's like 15,000 eggs for a 17-day cruise in New Orleans. But it's about a $40 million economic impact for our city. We talk about the cabs and the hotel rooms and the Queen of the Mississippi and the America. Two other vessels come in, so that's a lot of fun. Of course, y'all go off to St. Paul, Pittsburgh, Chattanooga, down to New Orleans. Hey, let's go down memory lane for a minute before we start. Y'all remember the Marymobile? We had like 82 Marymobiles in Memphis back in the 1960s. What was your favorite?
Dreamsicle.
Yeah, the buried treasure was mine, right? Or push-up. We're the only state to have a license plate in the shape of a state. Good state itself. Think about that. Tropical Freeze right over here at Park of Life Station where Starbucks is now. Remember the Luau? Yeah. The big shoe there on the bar?
Oh, yes.
They're talking about that all the time on George Flynn's radio station. You know what we sold out of that big shoe? Shoes.
Shoes.
A trick question. Parks Bakery, that little window, this is now Magnolia Paper Supply, but my mother would put this in the car, my brother and sister in the back seat, and have a stick of butter. You know, we'll get the, a hot fresh bread at night, rather than ice cream store, you know. How about Mr. Beale? Yeah. Carousel, Pippin. Carousel's coming back next year at the Children's Museum. A whole new wing, under restoration, really neat. Lakeland, Pappy's and Demi's. Of course, remember back then, the TV went off. We only had three TV stations, or four maybe. It went off at midnight, right? Good gracious. There's Dr. Flynn's station. Please, if y'all don't, I'm not trying to promote radio station, but what's so neat about what Dr. Flynn does is he asks people to call in and tell stories about Memphis and their history in high school, or about the polar bears over there at the Fairview Drive-In. Must be 10 million polar bears in Memphis. Some people say it's a different place, you know. That's Monk Casada, by the way, if anybody knew Monk, of our street characters. But they're always calling in, and he doesn't have commercials on the station. It's just gathering oral history and people talking about Treble versus Kingsbury rivalries or Cotton Bars landings and things like that. This is my favorite picture I found this year. You know, we always talk about how in the MGM movie, the lion that roars, he's from Memphis. He thinks it's Baldy from the Memphis Zoo. And I always tell people, I always ask them, you know what he's saying when he's roaring? Memphis. That's the only lie I tell right there. But somebody had to film that lion roaring, right? And look at these two guys right here. I mean, standing an arm's length away. I'm sure he was tame, but you imagine, that's how that actually was done. So think about that next time you see a movie. Memphis is number 6 on the National Register of Historic Places for listings in the country behind Washington, Philadelphia, Baltimore, New York City, and New Orleans. We're an old area. Okay, we got over 11,000 properties listed here. And that goes way on back. But I'd like to thank the Shelby County Archives for always being on call when I have a question. I'd like to thank Ask Vance too. But they're out there on the job, Vincent Clark and Frank Stewart. Of course, Memphis Heritage is turning 40 years old this year. The West Tennessee Historical Society. That little medallion used to be on the Ellis Auditorium building up there. There was 9 medallions. That was the Memphis one. I like that one. So, Dixon Lunch and Learn, April 6th. I'll be back next month. And as long as Lindley and I don't get our wires crossed up again, because she told me I was supposed to talk about 1946, right?
No.
76, okay. But we're going to talk about On the Tens on the 40th. I think you make up that title. But we're going to do all the things that happened like 220 years ago. Tennessee became a state. Or 140 years ago, on the centennial of our country. That's when we dedicated the Hebe Fountain downtown in Court Square. 50 people gave $1,000 each in 1876 to build that fountain. And their names are all engraved in the fountain wall there. When you go down there and look, the Goldsmiths, the Fontaines, the Hills, all those names. 2 years later, we went into bankruptcy for 14 years during the yellow fever epidemic. You know, so you see how the Civil War didn't touch us, really, but the mosquito did, and there was prosperity in between. September 6th, 100 years ago this September, we changed the way the world shopped for groceries in Memphis, Tennessee. We opened the first self-service grocery store down there at 3rd and Madison, Piggly Wiggly. It's now a Courtyard by Marriott. What's that, 60 years ago, those four kids got together at Sun Studio. You know the name of that group, right? Never sang of it. Mid-Dollar Quartet, December 4th, 56. How many people went to see the Beatles, the Coliseum? You know, that was the week after John Lennon had said, we're more popular than Jesus, you know? So we're burning records in Memphis. My mother wouldn't let me go. My sister snuck in. They set a box office record, the Beatles in Memphis. And then I met Ringo 20 years later. I had a picture made with a Beatle. The ugly Beatle, but it's a Beatle. Here in Memphis, Tennessee. They call it the ugly Beatle. That's me, really. Look at those glasses. Look at that hair. Look at that tie. And then right now, so 10 years ago, after Stacks opened up, they started a charter school. And if you look at the statistics here, the last 5 years, 100% of the seniors that have graduated have gotten a full ride to college or universities out of Sulzer, out of the Stacks charter school. That started 10 years ago. That's pretty cool. So, 2016, zero got here this October. You're going to be able to walk across this bridge right here on the north side. That's the Arrowhead Bridge, the new Big River Crossing. Surface is already in there. Arkansas is working on their side. We're working on our land side here. And you'll be 100 feet high over the river. That's pretty cool. So, Memphis, 1976, our nation's bicentennial. Our nation's bicentennial. Here we are. On or about our nation's bicentennial. Here we are, about plus or five. So 1976, what happened? Look at downtown Memphis in 1976. You know what's right here right now? Gibson Guitar, Western, FedEx Forms here right now. Look at Beale Street. Look at Ford. How Handy Circle comes around. That's Handy Park right there. You see they curved the street around like that. There's a Peabody Hotel. Look, that's where the pyramid eventually went right there. That's Edgestone Metals or Jones and Laughlin. Quite a different looking downtown in the area there. And that's where we were in 1976.
So what happened? Anybody want to take a guess?
I finally searched and searched and searched, and I found out what happened in Memphis, Tennessee in 1976.
Disco Duck.
Okay? Disco Duck. That is the worst song of all time. Right? If you ever listen to Disco Duck, y'all remember that?
Quack, quack.
Disco Duck. Rick Dees was a DJ here. This is the last number one song produced out of Memphis until the one that won the Grammy Award this year by Uptown Funk by Bruno Mars. We went 40 years without a number one song produced out of Memphis. It was Disco Duck. And he was a DJ that was very popular. They told him you can't play your own song on your own radio station. So he did it anyway. He got fired. He went to, I think, WHBQ. And then he went on to California to be Rick Dees in the top 40. So I'm blaming it all on Disco Duck. 1976, October 76. Rick Dees right there. Look at that haircut. I mean, that's me in 1976 as well, I think. The commercial appeal in 1976. Y'all remember William Thomas, I'm sure, the great writer there. And here's the July 4th page right here. I'll have it up in a minute. But William Thomas, this is kind of a few bits from his story there. The city is located on the east bank of the Mississippi River, but not many people look at the river anymore. Still, the city keeps getting farther and farther away from the river. The riverfront is in rotten shape. 8 years ago, a national magazine said it looked like a crumbling river town. That made people mad,
but they didn't do much about it.
And it crumbled even further, really. Here's that page right there. And then Lyman Sims, remember him? What a great funny writer he was. And his assignment that day on the front page of our bicentennial newspaper, he's talking about grits. You know? And it's a funny little story about grits and other things like that. That week in 1976, the Mid-South Coliseum,
always got to have a wrestling update, right? You know, we really birthed wrestling around here. But here's a wrestling card, who won, in case y'all needed to know, from 1976. Lindley really wanted me to report on wrestling today.
But it drew 8,467 people. All right, can anybody tell me who that is? There you go,
Lance Russell. Banana Nose, right? Jerry Love always called him Banana Nose. He always sold those extra clothes on TV and everything. There's your Mid-South Coliseum. You know, it opened in 1964 as the first public facility assembly building in Memphis, opened with integration of the races and design. Equal access, seating, concessions, restrooms. It was placed on the National Register of Historic Places for that. And right now, just to give an update report, the new administration said the slate's quite clean, no preconceived notions about the Coliseum or a park to go in there or whatever. So we'll just see in 6 months or so what's going to happen. But Jerry Lawler actually wrestled twice that night, you know. He said he may open up a restaurant on Beale Street. Back to the future, huh? There's Elvis's last concert in Memphis was in 1976 at the Coliseum. Y'all heard of Elvis, right?
How about the Malco, November 2nd, 1976? This is the last movie that showed at the Malco. From 1940 to 1976, it was a big movie screen. We had five movie screens downtown. Remember? The Strand, the Warner, the Palace, the State, and the Malco. And the Malco outlasted them all, mainly because, again, this is the 100-year Malco. They had a movie in power over the South instead of the State. But look at the name of the movie. Things had gotten so bad. The Four of Us, or House of a Thousand Pleasures. That's where we were, at the Malco back then. Tennessee beat Memphis State on November the 6th. 21-14, that's a pretty good game right there at the Liberty Bowl. Now that's not a football coach. Anybody recognize that face right there? That's Wade Yates, the basketball coach. The Tigers were 21-9 that year, and they went to the NCAA tournament. Wade Yates lasted two more years. How about the Liberty Bowl that year, December the 20th? Paul Bear Bryant, when they didn't have a good season at Alabama, he came to the Liberty Bowl several times. In 1976, he came here, beat UCLA, the number 17 in the country, pretty bad, 36-6. Of course, it was 6 years later, he announced coming to here to take the game, and a week later, he announced his retirement. And we had 1,000 requests for media that day, media credentials to come to that game. And then he passed away 3 months later, and we named the street the Fairgrounds for him, Bear Bryant Boulevard. Actually, the name of the street was Alabama Street. Fairgrounds, since we're in the Fairgrounds, remember the Fairgrounds way back then? The Mid-South Fair, Mid-South Coliseum, Memphis Memorial Stadium. The name didn't change until 1977. Came to Liberty Bowl Memorial Stadium. The Memphis Blues. Anybody know who the Memphis Blues was? That's between the Chicks and the Chicks. that was our baseball team. We didn't have a baseball team in 1977. Liberty Land was opening that year, the Zippin' Pippin. The Pippin became the Zippin' Pippin. Many people face the Pippin. It's the Zippin' Pippin of the new name. And the Carousel was there. The National Guard Armory, the Memphis Belle was over the National Guard Armory. The Fairgrounds had a swimming pool, the Children's Theater, and seven baseball or softball fields there. There's some pictures of the Fairgrounds. There's a big old swimming pool.
Weather on the nines here. Take a break. Is there still raining out there when y'all are coming in?
Yeah.
Well, let's think about the weather back in 1976, okay? The hottest day was July 26th. It was 97 degrees.
If you listen to Rick Dees, there's always degrees, you know. We always had Mayor Chandler on there. Yes, sir, Mr. Dees. Remember that?
Yeah. Mayor Chandler's a good sport. He came down in the 1990s to get on a riverboat when I was working at it one time. I wasn't going to let him on a riverboat, but he said, yes, sir, Mr. Dees. Like the other radio. He just howled. He was such a big spirit. He said, you know, as a politician, you can't take yourself too seriously. So he always loved kidding around with Rick Dees. It was really neat. The coldest day was December 31st at 9 degrees. The first reported snowfall in 1976 was November the 11th. The humidity, the least humid day was April. It was 38%. The most was in September. And it was, the month was, that's a month, by the way, it was 53%.
So September was very humid.
That year compared to summertime. Daylight saving time was April 25th, you know.
Remember, that's when you used to spring forward. By the way, it's this Sunday.
Yeah.
It's still in the winter, so we don't spring forward anymore. We winter forward, right? We still fall back.
But it was April 25th to October 31st. The wettest day was September 4th. It rained 3.5 inches.
I bet we're getting close to that today
here. The clouds, the clearest month was November. It was 63%. Days where it was clearer
more than cloudy.
Whereas the cloudiest month was March. 65%
of the days were more cloudy and clearer.
And you see This is the, that's the rainfall right there. There's that 3.5. So we were having spikes of rain like we do now. Here's the temperature for the year.
Mine's all crazy on weather. I mean, don't you think people are going crazy on weather right now anyway all the time?
But look out, it's probably not much different today, 40 years later. City Hall, who was in City Hall? Life Chandler was the mayor. Look at some of these names on City Council. Mike Cody, Fred Davis, Pat Halloran,
he had a four-year term
before he went to the orphan. J.O. Patterson became our first black mayor in Memphis due to the succession of Mayor Chandler when he resigned in 1982. Here's Mayor Chandler right there.
Now, what's funny is when you go to Wikipedia to get a picture of Mayor Chandler,
the picture of Jackson Baker shows up. So Jackson Baker wrote the obituary here and had his picture of that as an obituary.
That's been like after 2 years.
Sometimes see Jackson Baker, we laugh about it, you know. There's Mayor Chandler talking to Reagan when he came to town running for president that year.
The Memphis, we had two newspapers, remember that? Back in 1976, the Memphis Press Cemetery closed on Halloween 1983.
But there's the old Memphis Press Cemetery,
for those of you who don't know, is an afternoon newspaper.
And my fondest memory of that was I was living on Highland Avenue,
and Kevin Kane was my paper boy. And he was the worst paper boy ever. He couldn't get it near, you know, old box full of little bitty papers. And I tell all that story, and then I told it to the wrong group of tourists one time, because they were with Kevin that night. So he called me up the next day on bottom left and said, so now I have to say Kevin Kane was the Whitey Ford of afternoon carriers, like the Yankees said.
Kevin will buy me extra beer if I can say that. But that's the last paper right there, October 31st. The airport. Of course, Roy Holliver designed the airport. Those are the champagne glasses right there. Beautiful airport. It's unfortunate right now, I think, that we got a garage bigger than the airport blocking it. But it is what it is.
Remember Republic Airlines and Southern and Brandeis and all those airlines?
Here's Gerald Ford came in. He was running for president.
Well, he was president, but he's still running.
campaign. And Reagan was in town a lot through here. And they're both at the airport that year. The Memphis tourism product in 1976,
it was not a whole lot. We had the Memphis Zoo, and it was in a very bad state. And you look at the great state it is in now. You go back, it almost closed. And one of the reasons why was another issue was the I-40 expressway issue and the right-of-way coming right through there. And so the city wasn't putting much money in that time of indecision into the capital improvements of the building, so they deteriorated, unfortunately. And so I had a whole lot of catch-up to do in the 1980s when they did determine we can have that land back. And it's really has come back to be a great zoo, but
one problem. And Pink Palace was around. Of course, it opened in the 1930s. Victorian Village, Memphis Queen Line had only two riverboats at the time,
so they started building a third riverboat in their backyard. The boat would go down and ride the Memphis Queen 3. They built the hull in their backyard down in Whitehaven on Shelby Drive. 100 feet long, big backyard, 25 feet wide, and they moved it with a house mover down Shelby Drive to
Highway 61 under Keller Lake and launched it down that boat ramp and towed it up to the cobblestones and tied it off and welded out the first, second, third deck, smokestacks, and pilot house. Took them 3 years, a family and crew, to build that boat from scratch. Mm. They liked it so much, that's the Memphis Spring 3. They did it again in 1982 and they built the Island Queen the same way. In fact, this was going down Highway 61 in 1977, the same time Elvis Presley's funeral was going down Highway 51. So it was a big traffic jam in Whitehaven that day. You know, Elvis' funeral in 77 had 100 trucks or vans of flowers. 100.
Goldsmith's Garden Center over here, Mrs. Botanic Garden, Gammy House, Victorian Village, Chuckalissa Indian District. That was basically our tourism problem.
Not the Brooks, too. Not much there. Oh, and then, of course, it started in 71. Actually started in the 60s, but on March 3rd, 1971, the Citizens of Reserve Oak Park won a lawsuit. They fought the city, the county, the state, most of the neighborhoods, and the national government, our federal government, about that expressway going right through Midtown and over to Park. And it was Citizens to Reserve Only Park versus Volpe, V-O-L-P-E, Secretary of Transportation. March 3rd, 1971, but it kept on lingering and lingering and lingering, and finally, I think it was 1981 or 1982, the Department of Transportation finally gave up the rights to go through there, and that's how Sam Cooper got built on down to where it did. You look at some of these pictures here. Dave was happy about it, wasn't he? 1981, when the plans were finally scrapped. And then in 2003, that 3.5 mile interruption for 40 years was completed by being rerouted around the north part of the city.
So we finally did complete I-40 through Memphis. It just went around Memphis rather than through Memphis. And now we're fighting over that space rather than being an expressway for a parking lot. So
it goes around, comes around. So there were Midtowners here, their names lasted all through that. There's an award named for Sarah Hines. This is the bus lane. Remember the old bus lane going through there? When I was a kid, the rite of passage was when you got your driver's license, you had to drive the car down the bus lane. Not be caught by the cops, you know, because there's no cars allowed. And then look right here. This is west of Overton Park. So that's where I-40 comes across and turns to go north and around the town. But look how they cleared out everything through there. It's just amazing what had happened. Here's the Overton Park shell, speaking of Overton Park, back in 1976. You know it is the 11th shell now, but it's built in 1936 by WPA program. Memphis Open Air Theater, Hal, the Bid City. They're undergoing a big renovation right now. This will be the 80th anniversary of the Over the 11th Shell on September the 13th this year. We're doing a historical marker for that this year. If y'all been to the 11th Shell program, I'm sure. 50 free shows. What a great job they're doing with the 11th Shell. All right, it was the last year of the first one. Back in, you know, we changed the way the world shopped for groceries in 1916. Well, we changed the way the world traveled. We opened the first overnight roadside lodging chain out at 4941 Summer. That's the Minden Hall right there. Arch Bakery would be right there later on. It was the first Holiday Inn, and it finally closed in 1977. It lasted, what, 25 years. They got tore down in 1993. This is where our funeral home is now. But the actual name of the restaurant there was the first one. So this is the last year of the first one. Another last year, well, there's the last year of our minor league baseball team. We're going to have a minor league baseball team next year. And look at all the names we have for our baseball teams over here. You just thought we were the Chicks or the Blues, but we were the Fever Germs. Back in the 1880s, the Browns, the Egyptians make sense. Chickasaw was not chicken, it was Chickasaw Buddy, you know, the Native American, right there. I just don't know about the Fever Germs. That comes from John Gonzo, though, that's real stuff right there. This in 1976, you get out, the Colonial Country Club was right over here. They moved on out to Countrywood. And they come into there in 76. They didn't have a TV contract in 77. It was the last year to have a TV contract. During the Carter recession years is what they called it. Times were tough. And, of course, Vernon Bell and Don Drinker and all these guys, the local guys are in charge of it, are all worried about it. And, well, Danny Thomas comes in and goes, "Don't worry about it. I pray to St. Jude today and everything's going to be all right." So this is in 1977. I'm skipping 1 year forward here just to tell the story. And that very day, Gerald Ford did a hole in one. Okay? He's known for more for hitting people in the galleries than hitting three. And then 2 days later, Al Haberger here shot a 59, the first 59 ever shot in the PGA Tour. The very next day, they had a 3-year contract for CBS. Take you to works. This is a scorecard. I got to make this in large scorecard. I was doing calligraphy in the room there. And Danny Thomas gave it to Al Haberger. I made it for me. But they gave it to him as a commemorative. So we made another one 10 years ago. He's known as Mr. 59. That's kind of a neat event to tell you the power of St. Jude and Danny Thomas and all that. And of course, there's our last full year with Elvis, 1976. You know, this is a headline. I don't know why this is my favorite headline. A lonely life ended on Elvis Presley Boulevard. It's just such a line there for probably the most famous person in the world to have a lonely life. There's Elvis with Dixon right there. You know, in the 1960s, Elvis did like 3 movies a year for 10 years. Imagine anybody doing that, you know. Paper Sprint Special Edition about Presley. Skating, remember skating out there on Summer? Of course, it was on the Summer Avenue side over there on the north side. Later, we moved on down to Old Summer Avenue and finally burned down about 10 years ago. It's a paint company there, I think, or county glazing contractors. And the Malco drive-in, there's probably about 400 drive-ins left in the country, you know, and I've always enjoyed going out to the Malco drive-in. We had about 15 during the heyday of the drive-ins. This is the only one left. We thank Malco for doing that. They got this Volkswagen sitting on top of it. If you ever drive by there, it turns like that. And the headlights are always on, even at the daytime. I can't figure that out either, but it's good to have the drive-in out there on Sunday. Hell of the Memphis.
Oh, yes.
Well, that's the action I'm on right there. Y'all can come with that. Now, I had to sit in the car. I was embarrassed to go into Hell of Memphis. My mother would go, and I decided to go into Hell of Memphis. I'm 12 years old. I'm not going there. Well, I showed this to St. Louis not too long ago, and sure enough, a lady came up with her jacket and said, look at that, Hell of Memphis in her jacket. There's her initials embroidered in there. She was so proud of it. So, anybody wearing a Hell of Memphis? Then Lee, you don't go there? Hell of Memphis. Churches, of course, a lot of these churches were here in 1976. Some of them are here in 1900 or in the 1880s. So let's go to the churches. Calvary here on the left, of course, we're competing today with the Waffle Shop and the Lenten Preaching Series through, I think, March 18th. But it's the oldest public assembly place in Memphis. You think about places where people could assemble. Churches are one of them. Dates back to the 1830s. Funny story about First Presbyterian Church here. It's lasted all through this time. And it was built. There weren't any buildings around it. And so the sanctuary was put on the second floor, and they opened the windows to get the cool breezes to come through, because back in the 1880s, they didn't have air conditioning. And another reason why they said they built the sanctuary on the second floor, you're closer to heaven. Old snobby Presbyterians, right? Beale Street Baptist Church, another church of the black churches in Memphis, and it's still active, barely. I think it's on life support, to tell you the truth. It's a wonderful old building. Here's Ashmi, I can't pronounce it right, Mishnah Temple, built in 1927. It's right behind the Westies. But back in 1970s, the 60s and 70s, 76, it was a disco. It was Club Rainbow. If y'all remember going by there on Jackson Avenue. Favorite temple. This was built in the Second Presbyterian Church. They moved out in 1950, so in 1976. It was a Claiborne A&E congregation. It's been closed for about 10 years. It's been bought by Neighborhood Heritage or Preservation. They got plans on saving the building and converting it. This is the building in 1968 that all the marches originated from. Dr. King's last march of his life originated. You see that poster, I'm a man, all people with the... And that's where it was. Of course, Great St. Louis and beautiful Tiffany windows. You know, Great St. Louis there. First Methodist Church, unfortunately, on October the 6th, 2006, had a fire. Well, that was a beautiful church right there as well. St. Mary's Catholic Church on North 3rd Street. Alloa Presbyterian. Kind of looks like Rose College, doesn't it? But beautiful looking church there. St. Mary's Cathedral, you know, the Martyrs of Memphis, the Four Nuns, Constance, Ruth, Thecla, and... They're buried in the end of the Chapel of Cross in Elmwood, and the two priests, Parsons and Schuyler, from St. Mary's. Here's St. Peter Catholic Church, 176 years old, the oldest Catholic diocese in Tennessee, I believe, St. Patrick. And then here's the Lutheran church, Trinity Lutheran, right behind the jail. And the jail, they tried to get them moved three times in the 76. They said, we ain't moving. And they didn't. And when I went in there for the tour there, they said, well, what's a better thing for a prisoner to do than look out the window and see a church and see hope right there? So they're sticking there too. And those are Lutherans, and their sanctuary is on the second floor for the same reason as the Presbyterians. Close to heaven. How about restaurant names now? This is going to talk like a trip down memory lane here. Because a lot of these restaurants aren't here, but they were at their height in 1976. Anderton's on Madison. Remember that bar that was in there, the boat, the ship? It's over at the Cove. It got preserved. The building got torn down, but it's over at the Cove up on Broad Avenue, if you ever want to go see that. The old bar that looks like the front of a ship. Britland's Cafeteria downtown on Union Avenue. Now parking can be fun, garage, you know. Button Restaurant, right there on Southern, right by the railroad track. Our family used to go there to get on the train in East Tennessee now, to go to East Tennessee. Burkle's Bakery in Overton Square. You can get a meat and two for 99 cents when I was skipping classes in college in 1976. Coletta's on Parkway, still there. When I do something good and I feel proud of myself, I reward myself, I go to that Coletta's. And I go sit on the patio. You scratch your head and you go, what patio? That's that back room that's supposed to look like a patio. You got the little twinkle lights on the ceilings, it's your stars. The ceilings fade in the room. That's the patio. But it's a great food, a great atmosphere. Elvis went there, you know. The embers on top of Clark Tower over here. Four Flames. It's now Child Advocacy Center.
Ray Gammon's there at Parkway, and where the Exxon is at Parkway and Tresvant and Summer. I got some pictures going to pop up here in a minute. Justine's, I mean, I went to Justine's, but you knew about that on yeah.
John Grisanti's on Airways, the Luau. Pete and Sam's is still open right now on Park Southwestern Grill. It's now Dino's. Happy and Jimmy's is gone. It wasn't at Popper in Hollywood and now in Summer. Pappy's Lobster Shack was at Overton Square. Pitchfork was on Popper there at Collins and Union. What a great name for a barbecue restaurant, Pitchfork. Lamb's Eat Shop, that's still that should be L-A-M-B-E-S, and that was down there in Cleveland. You know where the Curb Market was there in Cleveland, Popper where the Kroger is now? Right across from Dyer's, you had Lamb's Eat Shop and the flowers and everything in there. Mark Twain Cafeteria, out at Summer Center. Those murals, remember those big murals? Well, back in 1993, I was general manager of Mud Island, and Susan Elliott made a deal. We had the firm being filmed in Mud Island, and the production crew of the firm, that's when Mark Twain closed. Spiros Angelicus was the man's name. We got them, we told them we're going to pay you for them, just let us get them off the wall right now and get them down to Mud Island. And the production crew of the firm went and picked them up. So they're all down in Mud Island in the museum, all those great Mark Twain murals and all that. They were saved. Leonard Spit Barbecue, down on McElroy. And then, of course, Huey's. There's 8 Huey's now. There was one then. And in fact, in the same city, of course, Dyer's has been around since 1912. So there's your Anderson's right there. Leonard Spit Barbecue on Bellevue. There's the interior Mark Twain. There's a big old mural right there. That mural's as big as this right here. There's the Britlands, you know, downtown. Let's see, that's Bunton Restaurant. Here's Overton Square. There's the Pitchfork. There's Beretta's, used to be on Summer over here. It's now a gas station. Coletta's. There's the first Crystal that we had in Memphis. It was over on Summer. The building's still there. It's like a Park Supply. This is the McDonald's. The first McDonald's in Memphis was on Summer. It was the 20th McDonald's in the country. You saw where Saul Kaplan passed away a couple of weeks ago, right? Now, they have a nice story about it on the business section. But when you go to the obituary page, Saul Kaplan, and alphabetically on the obituary page, that I promise you, if you go look it up, the next obituary down, the guy's name was Ronald McDonald. Ronald James McDonald from Marble, Tennessee. Go look at it. Not make fun of you, but this McDonald's, you go to Highland, that is the only one in the country that still has the arches that go all the way down to the ground. I can't find another one. They're all on the poles or in the building. And they get ready to relocate. Let's see, the title houses, remember the title houses? Open all night. There's a Fairview, there's a Polar Bears. There's Ray Gannon's, there's a kid sitting on top. There's the Inverse. Little Pig, which on Highland, now it's out on Quince. There's Justine's.
Yep.
The Luau, those two pictures, Pete and Sam's. The Knickerbocker was right over where Dixie Cafe is now. And Vernon Bell owned that. Sarah was his daughter. And she's opened a restaurant called Mortimer's. Mortimer was Vernon Bell's middle name. So that's what Mortimer's is. And she uses those same recipes of Knickerbocker over at Mortimer's and Perkins and Renshaw Expressway there. Knickerbocker, that's Leonard's right there. And then Pappy's Lobster Shack right there. Shopping, there wasn't a whole lot of shopping going on, you know, in the 60s. Southland Mall opened in 66 and Raleigh Springs Mall in 71.
Where are they now? Where's the Mall of Memphis that opened in 81? Or Hickory Ridge Mall, you know?
We had Laurelwood. When I was a kid growing up out here in East Memphis, I was equidistant between Laurelwood, Summer Center, and Poplar Plaza as a kid on a bicycle riding around, you know, and High Point Terrace, too. Sears Crosstown.
I saw my first Santa Claus at Sears Crosstown, or the first time I saw Santa Claus.
And it was still a viable retail center there. Whitehaven Plaza, Northgate, Southgate, Summer Center. There's Gold, there's the Bingo again, snuck in on me again. There's Raleigh Springs Mall. Hospitals, of course, this is Methodist with the Thomas Wing. There's that old escalator right there. My dad used to live right, walk rounds with him at the Methodist Hospital. Veterans Hospital, La Bonne before they opened that big new wing. Remember Baggins?
It was the largest hospital, about 1,300 beds and one roof there
before the implosion occurred in, 2006. Of course, St. Jude right there. There's old Danny Thomas standing in front of St. Jude right there.
And this just continues to expand.
About 3,000 people working in research and care, about 1,000 working in fundraising. Colleges and universities.
Here's something really weird about Memphis. We've changed all our names, you know? Remember Memphis State University?
Okay. Remember
Southwestern at Memphis?
That's the years they changed that.
Remember Christian Brothers College?
Shelby State Community College and State Tech, and Dixon and Memphis merged.
We used to have the Memphis Academy of Art. I believe it's Memphis College of Art now.
So the only ones that kept their names, well, the University of Tennessee School of Medicine actually became the UT Center for Health Sciences, or UT Health Sciences Center.
I can't figure that out yet.
And then Memorial College has been the same since they merged in the 1960s. So there's our colleges, MSU.
I still say Memphis State. You don't get in trouble with me for saying Memphis State. My diploma says Memphis State. I'm very proud of that 10-year diploma. When I started there in 1973, the tuition that semester was $169 for 18 hours. That's a deal.
I earned it. Banks, remember First Tennessee was First National. This is their move to the headquarters in the 60s. Of course, Union Planters was downtown. We had National Bank of Commerce, the CNI Bank, Leader Federal. Here's an aerial view of downtown during that time. Of course, you see, Mud Island's not there yet. The pyramid would be right there, Union American Tower. Civic Center Plaza was built in the 60s. So here's Jefferson Square, Blues Alley, Arcade, and Rondo.
That's about it downtown. Forget the Rondo.
The Arcade was a 24-hour restaurant
up until 1968 because of all the trains coming in.
And the night the king was assassinated, they went to dust the dawn curfew and they had to shut until everybody had to close.
They had to go find a lock. They didn't have a lock on the door.
Radio stations, there's some of the great logos. That was very 70s to me. About America's Bicentennial. The quarter, the dollar, the half dollar. So America in 1976.
Steelers beat the Cowboys. Is that good or bad?
Okay.
The $2 bill returned in 1976. Apple computer. You ever heard of Apple computer?
Officially got registered that year. The NBA and the ABA merged.
You see where the Memphis Grizzlies wear these Sounds jerseys that are red?
Well, that's the name of the team back then. It was the Memphis Sounds.
That's a real deal. The retro thing there.
We had a coast-to-coast bicentennial that year. You had the first class
of women to go to the Naval Academy.
Viking 1
landed on Mars
in 1976. Remember the Legionnaires'
disease in Philadelphia?
The hotel.
The Reds beat the Yankees. Is that okay?
Yeah, big red machine. Okay. Jimmy Carter got elected president. Is that okay? Okay. And Reese Witherspoon and Peyton Manning were both born.
Peyton Manning retired this year after football. Reese Witherspoon won an Academy Award here in Memphis for a role she played.
I Walk the Line, you know, in that movie, the Johnny Cash movie. So real quickly here, when I talk about 76, you really got to go plus or minus 5 years either way. By 1975, the Peabody Hotel had closed.
It was boarded up for 6 years, bought on the courthouse steps for $550,000, July 31st. Jack Bills told me last year he outbid Prince Mongo for the Peabody Hotel. Beale Street was totally fenced off. You couldn't walk or ride down Beale Street. Not a single business was open but A. Schwab. That's why his name's on the back of the building. You had to go in the back and get into it. And by 1979, there were more people living in jail in downtown Memphis than living residentially. There's 500 people living downtown and 1,000 people in jail.
And what was the city leader's mindset at the time?
Right? Disco duck, right? Think about this. We got to build a bigger jail.
And we built the only building in Memphis, you know, by its number. Okay, half y'all do that.
rather than its name, the jail, you know,
and that's where we were. No hotel over downtown, no Peabody, no Beale Street, no Mud Island. And little by little, we had to come back. So here's the Peabody Hotel being bought at auction there. You know, in those same steps right there, Lorraine Motel was bought for $144,000 by the Army of Mayor, getting the National Civil Rights Museum. The Orphan was slated to be closed and torn down to become the MLG&W parking garage. And Lucian, in 1976, Lucian Gillis and William Matthews from the Union Planners Bank stepped in and got over $280,000. Then they hired this guy named Pat Hadley. He did a pretty good job there, don't you think? So with less than $1 million in that little span right there, we saved the Peabody, the Orphan, and the Lorraine Hotel of Silver Rock. Where would we be without that? Thinking ahead. Well, there we were in the summer of 68. There's the airport that was there, you know. But it was twice as wide. We cut it in half, put it up to get above floodplain, we built the bridge. That's why we got 7,000 people living out there now. There's the old cobblestones. Summer of 72, winter of 72, the bridge is almost finished. It finished in 73. There's the summer of 81, Mud Island's open, convention center's there. Downtown Memphis in 68.
Kind of looks like downtown Memphis now. You go down to Beale Street, got these cop cars out there, you know, going in there.
But this is right after the Dr. King's march was broken up. The march started at Claiborne Temple. It broke up on Beale. Last march was live. Tanks on Beale Street. This was the beginning of the end for downtown. Having the desegregation of our school system in 61, the forced busing in the early 70s, and we had an outflight from the school system, from the city. And this is a triggering event here that splintered our city as well. Mrs. King came back and finished the march. And here now, Mayor Long has given up or negotiated. Everything got settled. And he had an open door policy in the mayor's office. But he had a loaded shotgun on right at his desk right there. Open door policy and a loaded shotgun. Now it's the site of the National Civil Rights Museum. All these things happened in the 70s. Mid-American Mall opened in 1976. It's on Main Street. Pedestrian mall. Population, we haven't grown in population in Memphis in 50 years. Mm. There's no stats. The CNI Bank opened in 71. It's now a visible music college. Remember the old terrarium in there? That's the bank lobby. The bridge opened in 73. It's, the Federal Express in 1973. It's grown. There it is. Convention Center grew in the late 70s. Civic Center Plaza, 63, was City Hall, Federal Building, 65, City Hall, 69, the County Building, had a big family. There we are, July 4th, 1976. Couldn't get a fire truck up and down the mall if you had a fire, or an ambulance. There's the Mid-America Mall. Civic Center Plaza became active in the 70s with Oktoberfest. Peabody finally reopened, in 1981. There's the March of the Ducks. Go West, young duck. That's a great cartoon. Of course, the court decision we talked about, here's the tree jumps out and hits a car again, over the car. I think that's a great cow alley. There's a sheriff's Peabody. A garage sale.
Anybody go to the garage sale for Peabody?
You did?
What'd you get?
I bought a chair and towels and
tablecloths. You still got them?
Yes.
Wow.
You stole those towels.
The lobby all torn up.
That's the world's greatest bargain. It's the March of the Dust. 200,000 people a year go see that right next to that ball. And the only item not on the menu at the Peabody Hotel is a duck, by the way.
40 years of Memphis Heritage, 1976. Open Square was on top back then. No Beale Street, no downtown. About 2011, Open Square was empty. Look what's rehappening with Memphis Heritage getting involved there. The top four names of buildings in 2011 were all active back in the time. 19th Century Club, Tennessee Brewery wasn't. Sears was, Hotel Chisca. It's 70% occupied now, and it's new development. So thank you, Memphis Heritage, for working through these last 40 years with us. We'll skip through the 80s here. And Bill Cosby, we don't need any Bill Cosby quotes, do we? In the 90s, there's the Peabody. Of course, in 1977 is when they went to computers, I think, on the cotton exchange there, and it went down. Some of the old restaurants there in the 70s. Wolfgang's was where the butcher shop became. It was Wolfgang's first. Robin Hood's, what did they say? It's Greek family served Southern barbecue in a building they rent from a Jewish family. Something like that. That's the Jan Burgers quote. The Pier, John Erica's, was a German restaurant. Dash was on the top of the 100 Club. Remember the on top of the 100 Main Building? Beale Street, original Beale Street land. Here's Beale Street back in the 70s again. There's a new plan. They tore down 400 buildings in the 1970s, urban renewal, never built it back. So no wonder things went down in the 70s. These are side by side comparisons of buildings right there. After the riot, there's Schwab's. Galena Building, that's Silky's now. Daisy Theater on the renovation. Now there's 25 clubs. It's the largest revenue grossing tourist attraction in the state of Tennessee.
And we drink a lot of liquor downtown. And guess what? We're building a distillery downtown on Front Street. The canals are all dominant.
Brass Notes on Beale Street. B.B. King's Club came in 91. Again, lots of those are flippers. Here's the Malco again. Got renovated, came to Orpheum, 14 days of Broadway in 83, now there's over 100 days of Broadway in the new Howard Center. This is where parking can be funniest now. That was the Lowe's Palace till 1977, and Britton was right next to it. Here's Danny Thomas, St. Jude in the 70s. This ridge was almost finished. That's an end, not an end, isn't it? Then we are cutting the ribbon, Winchell Dunn, put the lights on in 86. Here's the cobblestones in the 60s and 70s. There's some riverfront right there. And see how we're cutting all this up to put over here so the barge tows can get a straight shot down to the bridge, under the bridge through there. Then we have to stabilize Riverside Drive after doing all that. Y'all are in the Holiday Inn River Monitor that time. This is where Church of the River is, Channel 3, the Artesian building. This is all developed now. We still got a traffic jam on I-55 right there. South Bluffs during that time, that's 5,000 people living there now. That was all 35 railroad tracks in the same day. See what's happened to it now. Of course, Memphis in May, that was the year before Memphis in May started in 1977. 27 teams in the parking lot of the Orpheum for the barbecue contest. Jefferson Square. My big four from Memphis, Tennessee are Pinkley, Wheatley, Holiday Inn, St. Jude, and Federal Express. Also started here in 1979 as Auto Shack. Got sued by Radio Shack. Had to change its name. There's 6,000 AutoZones now. There's zero Radio Shacks. Welcome Wagon is here. Duck Sun Lemon, the national headquarters, are here. Bear Bryant coached the last football game here. We had the first ever Public Enemy number one. We had the last Miss America. Some of y'all probably knew Barbara Walker. Crowned from a city and crowned in a swimming suit. Miss Tennessee was number 15 that year. Miss Memphis was number one. The pyramid is the sixth tallest pyramid in the world. The Big Game Bridge, that's the longest freestanding letter of the alphabet in the world. Nike distributes over 50 million pairs of shoes through Memphis a year. November the 6th, 1934 Street is named for when we joined TVA Power, but it's the only street in America named after a month, a day, and a year. That's just an odd reason. It's when we decided to vote for Power, not when we landed on the moon or Independence Day or whatever. Cuyahoga makes more fish lures than anybody. Barton makes more 3D glasses than anybody. Island Branch makes more hotel vinegar and bar soap than anybody. And our Kellogg's Fest makes more frosted flakes than anybody. So tomorrow morning when you're Tony the Tiger, think about Memphis Kellogg. We're the home of the blues, birthplace of rock and roll, cradle of soul, crossroads of America's music. We're the home of the independent spirit. We're the center of the known universe. That's not what I say about Memphis. There I am. I think my mother sewed that bow tie on there, sewed that jammed down, sweater and all. I mentioned that spelling bee. Now, I talked too much when I was a kid, getting in trouble all the time, sitting on the back of the church playing hangman, and somebody's busybody mother being in the choir often. We'd get home on Sunday afternoon, the phone would ring, it'd be one of those mothers, yeah, Jimmy, okay, Jimmy, go to your room, because I was talking. I never saw Sunday afternoon as a kid, really. So I came home in the sixth grade and said I'd won the spelling bee. I was allowed to sing, and they said, you're lying again, Jimmy, go to your room. I didn't get dinner that night, but school had to call the next day. Last second of achievement in my life. If you go to jimmyogle.com, you can come out and listen to me on the radio every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday at 6:40 in the morning, talking about positive news and this. And I talked about this today, didn't I? See, she listened. This, real quickly, a couple of things. This Sunday, remember Club sent an email a couple of weeks ago about the Women of Achievement. Anybody know about the Women of Achievement? For 32 years, the Memphis Area Women's Council has been putting together a program. And these different disciplines, heritage, courage, determination, steadfastness, initiative, vision, heroism. They got three books out. It's really neat. And this is Sunday at 2:00 at the Holiday in Memphis. So if you want to call Deborah and be involved in that, there's a telephone number, or just memphiswomen.org. If you do talk to Deborah, you tell her I said this today. She covered me when she worked at a commercial building in the 1980s and she came to town. I do a free bridge walk once a month on a Sunday afternoon at 2:00 across the Memphis Arkansas Bridge as a preview to the future Harahan Bridge, which opens later this fall. We get about 50 to 70 people come across and walk across that silly bridge. Want to go see Arkansas, all this mud. But I don't have to be. That's a mile over, by the way, too. You got to walk a mile back. So I go about halfway and kind of monitor people. I'm monitoring, but it's great views up there. I wouldn't hold my kid out over the rail taking a selfie, though. That's 100 feet down. But the boats coming by at 2:45, the bluffs, the docks there, County Boat Store, your bird's eye view over the barges running, looking out. Here's the boat coming to service out of the battle queue. Once a month now we do a free tour of the fairgrounds. So March 20th, that's two Sundays, April 17th, but we could go walk into the fairgrounds and talk about the history of the fair, Liberty Land, and the children's theater, and the swimming pool, and the chicks. Anyway, we got 100 people there on January 21st. Once a month, do a free tour of the Downtown Courthouse. That bust right there, cast on Andrew Jackson in 1835 in the White House. The oldest known bust cast on the sitting president in the history of our country. We got to sit in the hallway in Memphis, Tennessee. Used to sit out in Court Square until we got to face during the Civil War. So, but 11 different kinds of marble in that mouth building, hewn mahogany wood. Next Tuesday at 10 o'clock, we're going to sing Happy Birthday to Andrew Jackson. It's going to be 249 United States dollars are making drugs. Y'all better be there. We got cake. We're going to drink blackberry fizz, his favorite drink. And we're going to stand in this hallway right here. And about 20 of us are going to sit there and sing 8,000 Redcoats See How They Run to the tune of 3 Blind Mice. With Mayor. We get away with it. That's when Jackson ran the British out of New Orleans on the last time with the Tennessee Volunteers. The Shelby County History Festival was April 3rd in Davies, Maryland. We had about 24 organizations there. We got kids coming from FACS, fourth graders. They're costume actors. And they're portraying famous Tennesseans like Andrew Jackson or Dolly Parton or Little Debbie. And one kid was Mark Gasol, and he's in this basketball uniform. They have this little thing on the floor. You got to punch it, push here. They don't move until you push that. They're standing around the room. And of course, Mark Gasol went to Lausanne, and he was kind of tubby then. You know, he's known as Big Spain now, right? You know his big name, Mark Gasol. I'm known as Big Spain now, but back when I was at Lausanne School, they called me the Big Taco. That's how the kid starts out. It's a really cool thing. About a minute's feel, just like our adult coming actors do. And they'll be there. The Heidi Hill High School Orchestra will be there, which is a quartet. We have free carriage rides as well. So it's a neat display. It's a good thing in history. And then every Tuesday, starting April 5th, I do a free tour of a downtown section, like 4 or 5 sections on the sidewalk. Here's the dates right here. That great Union Avenue manhole cover history tour will be here before you know it. But Cotton Row, Mount Pinch District, Court Square is around here. It's really a lot of fun. A couple of riverfront park series where we do the Southern Park set in a very interesting, going to the Marine Hospital, the Metal Museum. And we do the Cobblestone Wharf and the Sultana. And on Sunday, May 1st, we're dedicating a historical marker for Johnny Cash in Memphis. It'll be right here. The old Galloway United Methodist Church, but in the basement there, it was called the Abbey, the Pioneer Class. It was a women's class. Johnny Cash was 1954, just got out of just hanging around Memphis trying to sell vacuum cleaners or whatever. Wasn't doing any good, but he was rehearsing, wanted to sing, and he was down here where the lit building is on Union. It was called Automated Sales, and they were rehearsing in the back part with Marshall Grant and Luther Perkins, and the postmaster heard him singing, so they were singing gospel music. So he went and told his sister, who ran this pioneer class in that basement, and there, you got to get these kids to sing for us. That was the first time John R. Cash in the Tennessee Two performed publicly. It was in the basement here in December of 1954. Wow. So that was there. Of course, when he got to Sam Phillips, Sam says, you ain't going to make any money in gospel music. You need to speed things up. So he wrote I Walk the Line and Folsom Prison Blues and became Johnny Cash. You know, and this is the 60th anniversary of the release of I Walk the Line, May 1st. So we have a neat ceremony there. Mark Lowe has bought the building from Ken Schwartz. He's going to keep on renovating it. There'll be concerts in there. There's a concert March 26th. You know, last week on February 26th, that would have been Johnny Cash's 84th birthday. You know, he wrote over 1,000 songs. It was a great, prolific songwriter. I went up to Dice Colony a couple of weeks ago and went to the Toyota Home and the Dice Colony and the Southern Tennis Farming Museum. It's a great field trip. You go through the sunken lands, what they call it after the earthquake in eastern Arkansas. And then they'll put raising $75,000 to $100,000 for a statue there, which will be right on the north side of the building. There's a vacant lot there. The historical marker will be there. And it's called Legacy in Memphis. And they're going to try to raise money to build statues to musicians around town in their neighborhood locations. And now, 2019, be prepared for the Shelby County Bicentennial. That's just 3 years away. We'll be 200 in Shelby County. Bartlett's 150 right now. I put this slide up yesterday to see how many people will be around for their bicentennial in 2066.
Yeah.
Yeah. And there I am again. Video. Write down that telephone number. Write down that email address. And come walk around. I'll be back here April 6th talking about the tens. Right? Talking about the tens. So thank you all for coming and supporting me. It'll be a pop quiz to get out of here.
Wonderful, wonderful.